guys. I hope that you guys are doing amazing wherever you are in the world. My name is Boom Shikha. And as always, I'm doing videos here to hopefully kind of bring some of my thoughts into a congealed, concrete way over to you. And sometimes I do a good job of it, sometimes I don't. But in this video, I want to speak to you guys about how recently I read a post that said, you know, this lady was wondering, where have all the worms gone? And it was funny because it was meant to be a joke. And I'm sitting there thinking, it's actually a really good point. Where have all the worms gone? When I was a child, I was born in India. I don't know if you guys knew that already. I think you already know. I look Indian, very much so. And I was born in Delhi, New Delhi. And my father, or my family's father's family, had a home there. In one of those tall apartment buildings with lots of dogs around that were really scary. I hate Indian dogs because they're treated so poorly. They're really, 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 really aggressive, especially with kids. They're like, they will bite you and eat you up in a second. And so we lived there, or we'd go there to visit in the summertime, right? And the summertime is, in July, August, is monsoon season in India. So we'd get loads and loads and loads of rain. As a child, it was great because there's so much rain to play with, puddles and rivers to swim in. No, not real rivers, disgusting rivers, but that's okay. And so we had loads of fun, me, my sister, and my brother. We used to roam around, play in the rivers, play in the puddles. And as soon as it rained, because I think this was in the 1990s. So then that would be, well, like 20, 30 years ago. I guess it was a lot has changed since then. But as soon as it rained and as soon as it stopped, there'd be hundreds of worms, earthworms, that would come out of the soil and they'd be outside. I guess because obviously they can't breathe inside the soil because the water is causing them not to breathe anymore or taking away the oxygen. In any case, they would all come out and they would just be all outside, and we'd just sit there and there'd be hundreds of them all around our feet. Now, thankfully, I wasn't afraid of bugs at that point, but there were hundreds of them, right? And eventually, as soon as they knew that the water had disappeared from the soil, that it had been absorbed by the lower layers, they'd go back inside again, right? Meanwhile, we had loads of worms to play with and poke with and, you know, do all these things to kind of do experiments with them and watch them walk and watch them move and watch them eat and do all that stuff, right? It was great for a child. But there were hundreds then. And now, obviously, when I walk around in India and I go into some monsoon season, which is very rare that I do go then, but if I do go, I see no worms at all. Not only there, but here as well in Canada. I mean, yes, I'm surrounded by trees here and you see there's nature around and you think, okay, everything's fine. But when it rains, where are the worms? Where are the insects? Where are the bugs? Where is all that stuff, all the beetles and stuff? There were so many of them in the past and now there's nothing left, right? And so it really makes me wonder, when I read that question, it was like a spark that came on in my head, because I thought to myself, you know, I'd only been thinking about the birds. Mostly for me, the indication of how healthy a place is or how much nature there is how many birds there are. And that's what I pay attention to, like, you know, how many birds are there around me? And if there are loads of them twittering away, especially in the morning when I get up, and there are loads of them, you know, singing their song, waking me up, doing all their thing, then I know that that area is pretty healthy in terms of the nature and the forestry and all that stuff around it. So when I was living in Thailand in that little bamboo hut that you guys remember, there were loads of birds in the morning. I'd get up and, you know, that was my alarm clock. I'd get up in the morning with hundreds of birds, different kinds of birds, sing-songing their way to the morning. And that's how I woke up every morning. And I knew that there, at that point, obviously, at that place, that it was really healthy because there were loads of birds singing, lots of insects, lots of bugs, lots of trees, lots of different kind of flora and fauna. Over here, obviously, it's a lot colder as well right now, right? So, I mean, it's getting to negative degrees soon. It's going to be negative one today as low, -1 degrees Celsius. So it's pretty cold, right? And that means that a lot of things can't survive here as much as possible, as it is possible in tropical countries. But still, I'm noticing that there are very few birds here. I mean, I do see some, and sometimes I'll just be walking around and I'll see a bird that I've never seen before. I think to myself, where did you come from? How are you here? And how are you alive? And how do you get your food? And they're twittering away and they're singing their song. And I think to myself, you are brave and you are strong to have survived in a world that's obviously not even suitable mostly for human beings. It's so cold here, and especially when it snows, there's very little food available for them. So these little birds, what are they doing? How are they still here? The other day I was driving around and I was driving home, and on my way to home there is these two power lines, right? And these long power lines, and it's a huge parking lot. It's a very busy intersection, lots of people, lots of diverse people. It's Jane and Finch, so it's lots and lots of different people from everywhere, all over the world. And I noticed as I was sitting in the car waiting for the traffic light to turn that there were hundreds, and I mean hundreds, of birds overhead. They were flying and doing their, you know, formation flying, and they were dancing and playing with each other. And there were so many of them. And I had never, or it had been a while since I had seen so many birds in Toronto at the same time, you know, alive and well. It's been forever. And so, you know, these kind of little things. Why am I sharing this with you? I'm not crazy. I hope so. I hope not. The reason I'm sharing this with you guys, it's really hard nowadays because of all the news that we're hearing all the time. You know, these things are dying, that species is endangered, that species is extinct, this forest has been removed, this orangutan is dying. I mean, there's a billion news stories that are coming at you all the time telling you that the world is dying, which is true. Yes, the world is dying, the environment is being killed. We are idiots and we're ruining the world in the way that is catastrophic. But there are good news stories as well all over the place. And for me, it's not that I'm putting my head in the sand by saying, oh, there's loads of birds around and I saw an earthworm today, everything's fine. That's not what I'm saying. Is that, you know, there has to be, we have to look at the good stuff around us as well as the bad stuff, obviously. I don't close my eyes to the fact that there is a lot of shit going on in the world, but I also want you guys to be aware of the fact that there's a lot of good stuff going on around as well. And when the universe kind of puts all of these beautiful things in front of you, like I was driving around and I didn't have to pay attention to those birds, and in fact, probably all the other people in the cars around me, they weren't paying attention to it either. They're just birds. It doesn't mean anything, right? The same thing with that little bird that I saw in the mornings, that I see in the mornings. I have no idea where he comes from. He's so cute. He's so little. He's so beautiful. And I just wonder to myself, where are you coming from? And how are you still alive? And it's just so beautiful because I get to see these things and I'm reminded of the resiliency and the strength of Earth and of the species on it and how powerful it all truly is. And even if we are trying to destroy it all, I feel like we're not going to be able to do it. I don't think it's going to work. I don't think we're going to be able to do it. I know we're trying our level best, but I don't think it's possible. I think the Earth is too strong. I think the environments that we are surrounded by are too resilient. I think the species that we're surrounded by are way too strong. And I have hope that no matter how much we try, we're not going to be able to destroy it. That's just my hope. And the things that I see around me, you know, all over the place, it makes me feel good about the fact that I'm still here and I can observe all this stuff happening. The beautiful birds that are still there, you know, the trees that are surrounding me right now, the river that's pretty clean, you could pretty much drink from that water. So it's nice for me. I feel grateful that I can witness all this stuff as an observer, as a consciousness. I might not be alive for that long. I might not actually see what happens in the future. But I do know that the environment is and the ecosystems here are so resilient. I have hope that something good will happen in the future. I want you guys to have that hope too. Not to have our heads in the sand, but to have hope as well. All right? Again, I hope this makes sense to you guys. I'm so grateful that you guys are watching and listening and subscribing. I hope that you guys are finding all this useful. And again, as I said, if you guys have questions, please message me anytime. All my contact information is in the description below. And if you guys want to just comment below, I read all comments, so please do. Thank you again, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye for now.